Good afternoon, Pauline.
Well, good afternoon, Ben. I'm so glad you could come to the shop today.
Thanks for having me. This shop is amazing. It's so beautiful. And I love all of this old machinery that you have here.
Yeah.
I'm really intrigued about this contraption in particular.
Mm-hmm.
What is it and what are you doing on it?
Yeah, so this is a weaver's loom. With a weaver's loom, I take threads and I turn them into cloth, like what we're wearing today. So what I've got here is a warp made of cotton, like this plant right here. And I've got a weft on my shuttle over here that's made of wool. So I have a blend of wool and cotton on this, and we're gonna make a nice shawl.
Do you know about what percent you're using between the cotton and the wool?
Probably about 60% wool and about 40% of the cotton.
And do people still wear a blend of cotton and wool? Is that something that we wear today as well?
Absolutely still a blend that we wear today. Cotton, wool, there's new blends too that are more modern.
What kind of fiber is this one?
This is actually flax. It's a plant. We grow a lot of it here in Salem. Inside of it are these little hairy fibers.
You know, I use flax in my trade as well, but what we do is we take the seed heads from the flax and then we press them into an oil. We use that oil in the finishing of the woodwork, like a varnish.
Yeah, I've heard that before.
So you're gonna process this and then that eventually goes on the loom as well?
Yes, it could go on the loom. It's a new thread though, we call it linen. We use tools to break the hard outside part and then we comb it to get it smooth like hair.
That's beautiful, and it really does look like hair.
I know.
But from there, don't you have to turn it into thread before it can go up on the loom as well?
Yes, actually I do. I use this tool called a flax wheel to ply the threads together to create thread.
Okay, I can see that now. Well, this flax wheel looks like a really old one to me. Is it an old one?
It is a very old tool. It was made by a turner almost 200 years ago. His name is Simon Light.
How do you count all those threads?
Well, you know, that's the hard part, actually, besides the fact that this is a very hard thing to operate. And we use something called a skein winder.
A skein winder.
So that I can measure out how much. Can I show you my skein winder?
I'd love to see it. And if I remember right, too, some people call the skein winder a weasel?
Yes, actually.
I do remember.
Yes. This one happens to count out 30 yards. And what I really needed you to do was see if you can make me one that could count out about 225 yards.
225 yards? Yeah, I think I could do that, but I have to figure out how this thing works. And it looks really cool. It almost looks like an early clock or something like that. And you've got a worm gear up top, and then you've got this bigger gear being turned by the worm gear down below. And so it's probably multiplying the circumference of this. So let's go ahead and figure out what the circumference is. So if I take this piece of string, and I wrap it around the wheel once, and then I cut it off, and then I measure it, and I've got my stick of inches here. So I've got 36 inches, which is gonna be 3 feet, which is 1 yard. And I'll stretch that string across it, and it looks like we're gonna have a full 36 plus another, that's about 7 inches. And now if I look at this, there's 25 teeth on that big gear. So if I'm wrapping this around and it's wrapping thread on the entire time, it's going to count up 90 feet. And if my math is right, you take 90 divided by 3 to get the yards and it would be 30 yards. All right, Pauline, so I think I know how this works and I think I can make one that counts to 225 yards for you.
Great, thank you so much, Ben.
You're welcome. I'm gonna run down to the shop right now.
Okay.
All right, Pauline, I think I was able to build it for you, and I think it's gonna count to the 225 yards that you wanted.
Oh my goodness, it's beautiful, but it's huge.
It is really big. I had to figure out how to do multiples of 100 so it would count all the way up. So the way I thought about it is if we could get a circumference around this wheel that was 2.25 yards, and like I say, multiply that by 100, then we could move that decimal point over two places and have 225 yards.
Wow, that is huge. So there's actually a gear that can count that much?
So remember when we were talking about the other one, do you remember how it had the one big gear that mm-hmm. counted to 25?
Yeah.
So what I did is I broke it down to make gear ratios so the gears would act like a clock, and those clock gears could count all the way to 100.
Okay, wow, it's hard to believe you still could fit that in that box.
Well, let me show you how it works.
Okay.
I did the one worm gear, and that one worm gear is turning a gear underneath it that has 10 teeth on it. And that gear has a worm gear attached to it. So it takes 10 revolutions of this wheel to turn that lower gear around once and to turn that worm gear around once. So if we had 2.25 yards and we turned it around 10 times, we can move that decimal point over one place. We've got 22.5 yards at this point. That gear, or that worm gear, I should say, is turning another gear below it that has 10 teeth as well. So that other worm gear has to turn 10 times to rotate that last gear all the way around. And what you see here is that last gear rotating all the way around. And so instead of a clock face being laid out with 12 hours, I've got this clock face laid out in increments of 10, so 10 turns. When it gets all the way around, it's going to let us know that we've wrapped up 100 turns, which is 225 yards. Well, I learned a lot about weaving in Salem today, Pauline, but something I'm curious about is that, was this a trade that made good money for the Moravians?
No, actually it was very hard physical labor, and we couldn't keep up with the demand, nor could we compete with fabrics that were coming from places that had factories and industrialization. You know what? I bet if you talk to Joel Cook, he can tell you all about it.
Okay, I appreciate that. I'm gonna go do that, and thanks again for your time, Pauline.
Thanks, bye.
Bye.
Hey Ben, how's it going?
It's going well, Joel. I was just down in Old Salem talking to Pauline mm-hmm. about the weaving industry in the 18th and early 19th century. She said that I should come up and talk to you about the rest of the story.
Yeah.
So where is it we actually are?
So right now we're standing in front of the Freeze Woolen and Cotton Mill, which was constructed in 1836 and became operational in 1837.
So how is it that this place changed the industry of weaving in Salem so much?
So in Salem originally it was a cottage industry, which means they were working on hand looms and producing material at a lot slower rate. The mill industrialized that, so it was producing on iron looms using steam power, which was a lot more productive but required a lot more labor as well.
So how did they deal with needing a whole bunch more laborers?
So this mill used enslaved labor. So it's actually a little bit different than Salem because it's just outside of Salem. So inside Salem, they always had enslaved labor. It was always a part of their system to use the American slave trade, but it was on a much smaller scale. Here you're seeing a lot more numbers when it comes to enslaved people working at this site.
How many enslaved people do you think actually worked at this mill?
So in 1840, you had 7 enslaved people working here. But 30 years later, at the beginning of the Civil War, you had 44 enslaved workers.
So what kind of material are they actually making in this mill?
Free Salem jean.
So jeans, like kind of like what I'm wearing today?
No, so it would be slave cloth.
What is slave cloth?
Slave cloth was a cheaply made material that was produced in mass that would have been used to clothe enslaved people. So it would have been looked a lot like what I'm wearing right now, and it would have been shipped by rail from mills like this to places in the Deep South.
Thanks a lot for explaining this to me, Joel. I feel like today we followed a thread of industry through nearly 100 years of Salem's history.
Yeah, we've learned a lot about textile production in the past. But take a look at the clothing that you're wearing right now. Take a look at the tag on the back. Who made it? Where is it from? And how is it produced?